All right. Happy Sabbath, everyone. How was your week? Did you have a good sleep last night? Nah, I didn't sleep. I didn't sleep enough. So I hope I didn't fall asleep during the presentation. So, yeah. All right. The message for today is entitled, Are You Sure? The reason I chose this topic is because sometimes in our Christian walk, we doubt whether God loves us. We doubt whether we have assurance in His salvation. Who's experienced that before? You question whether, is this salvation real? Like, am I worthy of the salvation that God's given? So I thought it would be a good topic for us to talk about and learn about. Maybe remind us again that God truly loves us. And as I mentioned to Stan and Peter this morning, if the songs that we sang basically is the summary of today's presentation. If only we believe what the Bible says, that God loves us, we shouldn't have this problem. We shouldn't have this doubt in our mind. So before we go further, let's just open with a word of prayer and ask for God's presence to be with us. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the week that you've given to us. I'm not sure how everyone's week went, but we thank you that you've given us another Sabbath for us to come and worship you and to learn again, Lord, about your love towards us. Sometimes we have these doubts in our mind whether we are worthy of your salvation, but the Bible promises that we are worthy. And the very reason we can have that assurance is that you came and died for us. So be with us now as we open your word. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so I'll just do the summary up front, okay? So the Bible says in Ephesians 1, verse 5 and 6, the Bible says, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. So we are accepted in Jesus. If we are in Christ, we are accepted by God. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. So what does it mean to accept something? What does it mean to be accepted? To accept means to receive willingly, to regard with approval, to value, to esteem, to receive with favor. So when God says you are accepted, that means he has received you willingly, that he's regarding you with approval, that he actually puts value in you, that he held you in high esteem, and he receives you with favor. And this is so not because we have in any way merited his favor or his approval, but it's because his beloved, Jesus, paid the price in full. And I came across this quote a few years ago, I think 2 years ago, and it's never left me. So, Second Selected Messages, page 32, paragraph 3. If you forget anything from this presentation, please don't forget this one. And also the verse that we read before. We are not to be anxious about what Christ and God think of us, but about what God thinks of Christ, our substitute. Ye are accepted in the beloved. That echoes the verse that we just read. So are we to be anxious of who we are in the sight of God?
No.
We are to think about who Jesus is in the sight of God. And because of that, we are accepted in the beloved. Oh, I'm sorry about this. I don't know what happened, but so what does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be a Christian? Being a Christian means living a personal relationship, living in personal relationship with Jesus. And Jesus also wants us to have a deep and trusting relationship with him. It's a one-on-one relationship with him. And from that trusting and deep relationship, we are to feel accepted. We are to feel assured. We are to feel a sense of security in his love. And if that happens in our life, We can have peace and happiness and joy, and we can grow in faith. Faith can only grow, come when we are assured that Jesus loves us. That's right. And when we have peace and happiness and joy and faith, we can have a spirit-filled daily walk where we are looking forward for that day to come when Jesus comes again to save his own. But unfortunately, for many of us, you know, some of us put up our hands, we can have a relationship with God. We can pray, we pray, we read the Bible, we come to church, we come to prayer meeting, but there's no sense of assurance in our lives. And if there's no sense of assurance and security, there's doubt and fear. And the Bible says in 1 John 4, verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. And when there's doubt and fear, we can't possibly be happy and peaceful. And there's no joy. There's no spring in our step when we wake up in the morning, because we're not having that relationship with God. And when we don't have peace and happiness and joy, how can we look forward to the second coming when we actually dread whether we are saved or not? And how can we be effective in witnessing when we don't have the assurance in our lives? So there we go. That's a, you know, emoji. And I came across this word. I don't know if it's a real word or not, or something that people just made up. But it's, the word is atelophobia. Atelophobia means the fear of imperfection, the fear of never being good enough. And that's what many Christians say. Although I try my hardest to please God, I'm not really sure if I'm accepted. And you have this constant fear of being imperfect, not good enough. I'm constantly afraid that I'm not good enough. And you know, we have this voice in our head that says, you are not good enough, you're just not good enough. So atelophobia. Next time you think that you're not good enough and you have this fear of being imperfect, think of that word. And why is it that many of us feel insecure spiritually? These are a number of reasons that possibly can cause us to feel insecure in our walk with God. Number one, we have not fully given our lives to Christ. So if we have not made that full decision to follow Jesus, we may feel insecure. When we have not understood the message of justification by faith, we may feel insecure. When we try to earn God's favor through our own strength and works, we may feel insecure. When we have a known sin that we cling to in our lives, we may feel insecure. When we base our faith on changing emotions, you know, we may feel that God loves us one day and God doesn't love us the next day. Then we feel insecure. When we are discouraged by weaknesses and mistakes and believe that God cannot and will not accept us as who we are, then we feel insecure. Before we go further, I think it's important for us to talk about these two words, unworthy and worthlessness. Being unworthy and being worthless, sometimes we think that they are the same thing. But it's not the same thing. So sometimes we think unworthy is the same as being worthless. And many people say, I am a sinner, therefore I am worthless. But is that true? It's not really true, because being a sinner cannot ever make you worthless. Cannot ever make you worthless. Because being unworthy means failing to live up to requirements, failing to meet a standard. That's when you're not worthy. So let's say you didn't meet your KPIs at work, then you're not worthy, really, to get a bonus from your boss. Does that make sense? Yes? When you achieve less than 50% in your tests, you are not worthy to get a pass. You're not worthy to graduate. Yeah? And when you came last in a marathon, you can't say, I came first. You just can't, because you're not worthy to get that title. And when we sin in our lives, we are not worthy to have salvation. Does that make sense? When we sin, we are not worthy to have salvation. But that doesn't mean that we are worthless. So when you didn't meet your KPIs at work, you're still an employee, a full-paid employee. When you achieve 50% of your tests, you're still a student. You are a student. You know what I mean? And when you came last in the marathon, you're still a finisher. Yes, you didn't come first, but you're still a finisher. And when we sinned, you are a sinner, yes. But you are a sinner worth dying for. Does that make sense? So being unworthy and being worthless are completely they from east to west, basically. They're not the same thing. And I just want to remind us that, you know, when we struggle in our life, it doesn't mean that we are worthless. It doesn't mean that. Why? Because Jesus did not come for the worthless. He came for the unworthy. The fact that Jesus came and died tells us that we are of value, of infinite value. We are worthy. I mean, we are... Hold on, what was the word? We are not worthless. We have value. We have value in the sight of God. And a good relationship with someone is a relationship with a person who knows all your insecurities and imperfections, but still loves you for who you are. And that's Jesus for us. He loves us for who we are. We know we have value when God showed His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5 verse 8. So, does the Bible provide evidence whereby we can be sure that we are accepted in God? I believe the answer is yes. The answer is yes. Let's turn to 1 John 5. Let's turn to 1 John 5, verse 11, 12, and 13. First John 5, verse 11, 12, and 13. So 1 John 5, verse 11, 12, and 13. And the testimony is this, that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has what? Has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have the life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. So it is possible to have assurance. That's what the Bible says. That's what John is saying here. So what are the three things that we can take from this verse? Number one, as unworthy as we are, God, by His grace, has given us eternal life. God, by His grace, has given us eternal life. And number two, our eternal life is based on our clear and firm decision to follow Jesus. That's what verse 12 is saying. He who has the Son has the life. So we choose to follow Jesus. We choose to put our life in Him. And number three, it tells us, confirms to us that we can know that we have experienced salvation. We can know that we have eternal life. So, there are two ways of looking at this. And the way you look at the cross defines your insecurity or it defines your assurance of salvation. The first one we can see on the left is when we put ourselves above the cross. This will produce insecurity and false assurance in our spiritual life. On the other hand, if we put the cross above us, we can have full assurance of salvation. Like John said, he must increase, God must increase, and I must decrease. So we are not at the center of the salvation. God is. The cross is. And in order to have full assurance of salvation, our assurance must be rooted in a genuine, heartfelt surrender to Jesus, placing complete trust in Him. Remember Galatians 2, verse 20? I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I that live, but Christ lives in me. So we have give the full surrender to God to control our lives, to live essentially our life for Him. And number three, the foundation of our salvation is in justification by faith in the grace of God and not because of how much progress we have made towards perfection. But does that mean that we are not to strive for perfection? No, it doesn't mean that. God calls us to be holy just as He is holy. So we are to walk with Him. It's a process, it's a journey to be sanctified every day through Jesus. A quote from Steps to Christ, page 51. It says, it is a privilege to go to Jesus. It is a privilege to go to Jesus and be cleansed and to stand before the law without shame or remorse. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So after we go through the ABC of salvation, admitting that we are a sinner, believing that Jesus has died for us, and that through His blood we are forgiven, we can claim salvation. We can have assurance that He will save us. And so when we come to Jesus, we can have assurance that there is no condemnation. When we are genuine in our repentance and in our coming to Him. But the devil always has a way to deceive us, don't you think? The devil is a deceiver. So, and there is such thing as false assurance. There is, you may feel that you are assured of the salvation that you have, but the devil can deceive you as well. And once again, it is with this concept of putting yourself above the cross of Christ. And there are three ways, I think, that the devil can deceive us, and that's his plan of attack. Number one is for us to doubt God's promises. For us to read the Bible and say, yes, that applies to others, but that doesn't really apply to me. It applies to others, but it doesn't really apply to me. And number two is for us to rely on our own works and our own righteousness. So let's turn to Matthew 7, verse 21 to 23. Matthew 7, verse 21 to 23. I'm not going to have the verses on the screen for this particular slide, so I invite you to turn your Bibles to Matthew 7, verse 21 to 23. We are very familiar with this passage, I believe. So in verse 21, the Bible says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So we may feel that we serve God. Okay, I'm working for God. Then I can have salvation. I'm serving Him in the church. I come to Bible study. I come to the Wednesday seminars. I come to K group. I did this, I did that, I did this, I did that. And then somehow we expect that to buy salvation for us. And then let's turn to the next passage. Luke 18, verse 9. to 14. Luke 18, verse 9 to 14. Luke 18, verse 9 to 14. The Bible says, "And he spoke this parable, he being Jesus, to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others." That first verse tells you everything. So Jesus was telling this parable to those who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. In verse 10, it says, "Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other one a tax collector. Then the Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, 'God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortionists, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I possess, and the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as to raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.'" And Jesus concludes with this verse in verse 14. "I tell you that this man went down to his house justified rather than the other, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." So the second plan of attack from Satan is that we rely on our works and we rely on our righteousness, in our own righteousness. Just like the Pharisee, he was like, "God, thank you that I am like this. I pay the tithe, I do this, I do that. I'm not like that guy, I'm not like that girl." So that's Satan's second plan of attack. And what is the consequence when we actually rely on our own righteousness and our own works? Galatians 5 verse 4 tells us what will happen when we actually rely on our works and our own righteousness. Galatians 5 verse 4. The Bible says, "You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempted to be justified by law, you have fallen from grace." So when we trust in our own righteousness, in our own works, we have fallen from the grace of Christ. And how can we stand before His presence when we have our own righteousness instead of His? And the last plan of attack is conscious, willing disobedience. Let's turn to Jeremiah 6. Verse 15 and 16. Jeremiah 6, after the book of Isaiah, Jeremiah 6, verse 15 to 16. The Bible says, "Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? No, they were not at all ashamed, nor did they know how to blush. Therefore they shall fall among those who fall. At the time I punish them, they shall be cast down." Verse 16, "Thus says the Lord, stand in the way and see, and ask for the old path where the good way is, and walk in it. Then you will find rest for your soul. But they said, we will not walk in it." Okay? So conscious, willing disobedience will not give us a true sense of assurance of salvation, but rather a false one, because we think we have salvation, but then we go our own way, we consciously, deliberately, willingly disobey God and His instructions. So those are the three plans of attack that Satan is putting on God's people today, so that we can have a false sense of assurance of salvation. What about the feeling that we are not good enough? The feeling. Does God actually give us feeling for a reason? Is it a bad thing to feel something? Is it a bad thing to feel guilty? Yes or no? No, it's not. It's not a bad thing. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. It's not a bad thing. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
We've got feeling.
Yeah. We have feeling. That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. So in 1 John 3:20, it says, For if our heart condemns us, so given that we have, we are genuinely repentant of our sins, we come to God, we claim the forgiveness, we claim Christ's righteousness, and if our heart still condemns us, John says, God is greater than our heart and knows all things. Yeah? So if we are genuine in our repentance, in our seeking of God, but we feel as though we are still unworthy, there's a promise that says God is greater than your feelings. God is greater than your heart. And unfortunately, many people are plagued with doubts about their salvation because they do not feel safe. They do not feel good enough. And that is because they let the feelings drive their spiritual journey. Yeah? Just look at the illustration here. That picture there should tell 1,000 words. So, we must remember that our feeling can be deceptive. And yes, as Lynn has mentioned, feeling is not actually bad. But when we place the feeling at the forefront of our train, when it guides the train, our spiritual journey, then it is a big problem. It is a big problem. So the train begins with God's word, which promises to us that we have eternal life in Jesus. And we could never earn this through our own strength. So God invites us to trust His word and by faith, which is the second carriage, accept eternal life. So our faith in God is driven by what is written in God's word, just like what the song tells us this morning, that Jesus loves us, and this we should know. So God's word drives the train, and the faith comes after. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. And then our feeling should come after that, right? So the feeling, if our feeling drives this spiritual train, then it's going to be all over the place, all the time. Because we change our emotion, we change our thoughts and feelings. But when we put God's word as in the, you know, at the front, and our faith comes after, and our feeling comes after, then we can have a consistent and assured Christian life. I believe that. And so when our heart or feeling condemns us after we have completely surrendered our lives to Jesus, we should ignore it. We should ignore it because we have the Word of God telling to us that when we come to Christ, we are a new creation. When we come to God, knowing that we have genuinely confessed and repentant of our sin, we can have the assurance that God loves us, that we are accepted in the Beloved. Then what about our weakness? What about when I feel weak and sad and discouraged about my weakness? Is my weakness a clear sign that I am not saved? This may seem to be a humble way of thinking, but it is nothing more than a form of righteousness by work, because it says, although I have accepted Jesus in my life, I cannot have assurance of my salvation because I am not good enough. And the truth is that we can never be good enough. We can never, by our own merit, achieve eternal life. We can get nowhere with our own righteousness. And besides, the closer we come to Jesus, the more we realize that we are sinful. So in a way, like you'll always play this catch-up game. So you'll never feel assured anyway. Because even when you come closer and closer and closer to God, there's always something in your life that says, hey, that's not quite right. So this way of thinking is not, I suppose, the right way to approach it. And let's go back to the train again, you know, that God's word tells us that we're forgiven, that we have eternal life, and our faith follows, and then our feeling should follow after that. And let's just read this quote here. We should not make self the center and indulge anxiety and fear as to whether we shall be saved. All this turns the soul away from the source of our strength. Commit the keeping of your soul to God and trust in Him. Commit the keeping of your soul to God and trust in Him. Talk and think of Jesus and let yourself be lost in Him. Put away all doubts and dismiss your fear. Yeah, so weakness and assurance. So we have our own weaknesses, you know, Krispy Kreme and all these things, the good things in life. So what does Jesus tell us when we feel that we are weak? John 6, verse 37 to 40 says, "However, those the Father has given me will come to me, and I will never reject them. For I have come down from heaven to do the will of God who sent me, not to do my own will." Verse 39, "And this is the will of God, that I should not lose even one of all those He has given me, but that I should raise them up at the last day." Last verse, "For it is my Father's will that all who see His Son and believe in Him should have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day." So that's John 6, verse 37 to 40, which tells us that when we are weak, God will not reject us. We just go to Him, go to God. And Matthew 11, verse 28 says, "Then Jesus said, 'Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest.'" The next quote here says, it's taken from Steps to Christ, page 64. "There are those who have known the pardoning love of Christ and who really desire to be children of God, yet they realize that their character is imperfect, their life faulty, and they are ready to doubt whether their hearts have been renewed by the Holy Spirit. To such I would say, do not draw back in despair. We shall often have to bow down and weep at the feet of Jesus because of our shortcomings and mistakes, but we are not to be discouraged. Even if we are overcome by the enemy, we are not cast off, not forsaken and rejected of God. No, Christ is at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Said the beloved John, 'These things are right I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous.'" So yes, you know, we struggle and we make mistakes, we fall. But when we are truly repentant, when we are not willingly, consciously disregarding God's way and willingly commit sin, we can always come to the foot of the cross and realize that we are not cast off, that we are not forsaken, that we are not rejected of God, and we have a high priest in heaven, an advocate who we can talk to, who can intervene and intercede in our behalf. And in closing, there is a letter that was written from Ellen White to a sister, not her sister, but a sister in the church, who was struggling with this very thing. You know, she knows that God has died for her, God has attained eternal life for her, but she feels she's not worthy. She feels she's worthless. And we will close with this letter. And I just hope that if any of us are feeling the same way, we will be encouraged when we read this letter. So let's read. It says, "My dear sister, I have evidence that God loves you and that the precious Savior who gave Himself for you that you might be safe will not thrust you from Him because you are tempted and in your weakness may have been overcome. Now do not worry yourself out of the arms of the dear Jesus, but lie trustingly in faith,
He loves you, He cares for you, He is blessing you, and He will give you His peace and grace. He is saying to you, thy sins be forgiven thee, Luke 5, verse 23. I tell you, Jesus loves us although we err and are betrayed into sin. He will forgive us, He will pardon, and that abundantly. Gather to your soul the sweet promises of God. Look away from your wretchedness to the perfection of Christ. We cannot manufacture a righteousness for ourselves. Christ has in His hand the pure robes of righteousness, and He will put it upon us. He will speak sweet words of forgiveness and promises, and He presents to the thirsty soul fountains of living waters, whereby we may be refreshed. He bids us to come unto Him with all our burdens, all our griefs, and He says we shall find rest. We must therefore believe that He speaks pardon, and we must show our faith by resting in His love. This feeling of guiltiness must be laid at the foot of the cross of Calvary. The sense of sinfulness has poisoned the springs of life and true happiness. Now Jesus says, lay it all on me. I will take your sin. I will give you peace. Destroy no longer your self-respect, for I have bought you with the price of my own blood. You are mine. Your weakened will, I will strengthen. Your remorse for sin, I will remove. Then turn your grateful heart, trembling with uncertainty, and lay hold upon the hope set before you. God accepts your broken, contrite heart. He offers you free pardon. He offers to adopt you into His family, and with His grace to help your weakness. And the dear Jesus will lead you on step by step if you will only put your hand in His and let Him guide you. Search the precious promises of God. And if Satan thrusts threatenings before your mind, turn from them and cling to the promises.
So, when the question comes up to our mind, are we sure of the assurance that God has given to us, of the salvation that has been purchased through the blood of Christ? When we are genuine, when we come to God seeking to fully confess our sins and not, come to Him with our own righteousness, with our own works, and not willfully disregard and disobey Him, we can be sure, we can be certain that the answer is yes, that we can have assurance in Jesus.
Thank you, Brian, for that very reassuring message. And you know that the Holy Spirit is completely working within us and our church when our final song today is very relevant to our message. So please stand and let us all sing, Worthy is the Lamb.
Thank you for the cleansing flow. Now all I know, you're forgiven.
Father in heaven, Lord, thank you so much for your word today. Thank you so much for the assurance that you have given to us. Thank you that the Lamb is indeed worthy, Lord, that if we come to you in his name, we are accepted in the Beloved. And Lord, help us that in our daily life we can have this assurance, that we can have peace and joy in our lives and happiness, Lord, that we can go out and witness and just live a life that is spirit-filled, ready for that second coming to come. And Lord, as we continue our fellowship today, be with us. Bless the food that's prepared, and also bless those that have given sacrificially every week to provide for the church. So we thank you so much for everything. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.